So there were sit-downs, there were demonstrations. A lot of it was about the ability to school their own children and not have them sent to institutional schools. And there was also a media movement. And the media movement was about how do we speak in our own voice to the world about what is going on in this area, which admittedly is not an area that too many people travel in or are all that aware of. And it was interesting because it was actually a leader who was educated in the United States, goes by the name of Subcomandante Marcos, who went back to southern Mexico to work with the indigenous folks. And he kind of said, you know, guys, we need a media presence. We need to be able to speak as ourselves on the national stage, because Mexican press isn't going to report this. The New York Times isn't going to report this. They're going to report that we're a bunch of dangerous revolutionaries running drugs, and the Mexican police shot us dead as a result. That's what they're going to report. And if there's no counter reality, that's really what it will be. That's how the story will be told. So they created basically a media collective in the mountains, largely women, that distributed communiques from the jungle, and they said it was from the jungle, anonymously. I mean, it was under the name of Marcos, but that's no one's real name. Whoever that person is, and they've since retired, is in an unknown scenario. And these communiques came out of the jungle on a regular basis, and they told a story totally different than the story that was being told. And it changed the conversation about what was going on in Mexico. It made it different. So it was a shifting of the reality. And it got a lot of attention because they were rather spectacularly courted with a lot of drama and a lot of poetry. Marcos had had his college education, so there were intellectual quotes and jokes and cartoons and figments of the imagination. And it was an elitist kind of dialogue that people didn't expect to get from a bunch of Indians in the middle of the jungle. But the reality was that it was also telling a story about what was going on. And it was telling a story about what it was like to be in Mexico and about what these confrontations were between the indigenous folks and the Mexican police. And as we've seen recently in A.L. Zapinga, the Mexican police are kind of nuts and corrupt, killing people. But that's not the story that often got told. And you can see easily how this could become a story of, you know, backwards, primitive people who didn't want to modernize, or criminals, or people running drugs in the jungle. There are many forms the narrative could have taken that would have protected the activities of the police. So it was really important that the stories were told. And people in other parts of the world saw themselves in the Zapatista struggle in a way that they never would have otherwise. In other words, we're kind of cross-fertilization. People kind of look and say, oh, I get that. That's what's going on in Senegal. That's what's going on in Zambia. That's what's going on in Burma. It doesn't normally happen around the world. Normally, these things are incredibly isolated kinds of struggles. So you can see cross-fertilization on a small level, and you can see it on a macro level. You know, what happens when you shift the truth around, number one. And what happens when you cross-fertilize those stories with stories from other parts of the world, and the themes start to connect, and the connections start to be made, and there's a power that comes from putting those things together. And for someone kind of, you know, 8,000 miles away, looking at that and saying, oh, that's what's going on in the jungle. I saw that headline, all those people got shot, but I didn't know why. That's why. And that sounds an awful lot like the riot in Malaysia last week. Well, it is an awful lot like the riot in Malaysia last week. But you don't know that until these things start to reside kind of next to each other. Okay. So you're in Indianapolis, not in Chiapas. But there's still kind of an issue of cross-fertilization.
It's close. It's close.
Okay, well, I don't know how close. I mean, this is the part where you have to tell me. But there's stuff going on, and there's stuff going on that probably isn't in whatever passes for the daily newspaper that much, or, you know, appearing on the evening news, I would guess. And there may be someone else on the other part of town who is doing something pretty similar, and you may not know much about what they're doing over there in that other part of town too well. Although if you actually, you know, saw each other working, you would be like, oh, those are my people, they're doing my thing, we should talk. But that doesn't always happen. And if you cross sectors, let's say you go from labor to healthcare, or you go from environmental work to youth justice to police work, even more so. You know, much of the basis for the work is probably pretty similar, but you don't really know because you're doing your own thing in your own place, and you haven't put stuff side by side and said, oh, that's kind of like what I'm doing. And if you cross languages, maybe even more so. I'm sure that there's people organizing in Indianapolis in other languages. I don't doubt it for a moment. I have no idea where they are, and I haven't met them, but they probably are. And you may not have met them either. But again, if their stories were next to your stories, it might look kind of familiar. And maybe that extends out to the state, and maybe that extends out to the Midwest, who knows? But the putting of things next to other things, especially when all of those things are sort of, shall we say, the unheard stuff, the underground culture, the subversive politics, the living in co-ops, which is not what you're supposed to do, because you all know you're supposed to buy your own house with three bedrooms and a picket fence and not let anybody in except for barbecues on Sunday, because that's how Americans live. Or whatever it is that's going on that's a little not the mainstream, you know, really isn't being told. And it's not, you know, it's not connecting with the larger reality. And the truth is there's probably more non-mainstream things going on than there are mainstream things going on. I don't mean to get into the American dream language, but you know, that's not really how it is. We all know that. It's an idea, it's a myth that gets told. But the reality is most people don't live like that. Even the people who want to live like that don't really live like that. So, you know, the reality is essentially subversive. It's just that it's kind of pushed underground in favor of a narrative. And it's a narrative that supports corporate control of the country because it's a corporately controlled country. So when we pull those narratives out, we actively undermine corporate control of the country. When we pull those narratives out and put them together and connect them, we actively undermine government oppression, cultural oppression, racism, sexism, you know, every ism that there is, because all of those are essentially connected to maintaining a kind of hegemony in the society. For corporations, for the 1%, you know, for the small few that benefit from this reality, which is not all of us. I mean, you know, the only thing the Occupy movement did, essentially, was it made that mean 99% and the 1%, and just for that, they're amazing, because that's the truth. But, you know, society doesn't operate for the majority, it operates for a small minority. And the more that we can kind of get that through our heads, the more that we can see that when we combine our stories and our narratives together, we build power that way, in a really concrete way. And not just political power, but cultural power, and societal power, and art power, and, you know, all of those things that move a society forward, which is something that's robust, and vital, and connected, and real, and honest, and, you know, sustains and supports life, instead of kind of, you know, pushing down on us and the hopeless. So that glorious vision is maybe what you can get out of a co-op if it's done well. And that doesn't mean it's not a whole bunch of work, and that doesn't mean it's a whole bunch of decisions to be made. I mean, all of this is the case. And it doesn't mean there's not a whole bunch of other work going on. But there's a potential there to kind of lift up everybody's work. And there's a potential there to kind of lift up everyone's feeling about the reality, about the world that they live in. haven't lost the internet yet. So we have like this valuable tool that we can use, but it's like everything else, you have to go out and grab it and use it. Because if you don't, then they will. And then all of a sudden, it'll be like cable, you know, 5,000 channels, got nothing on. And we don't want that with this internet. It hasn't happened quite yet. So we got to grab it and use it for what will really, you know, make things better. And it doesn't solve every problem in the universe, but it does start to alter reality piece by piece and make the world better. So I'm going to stop there for a second. Are there any questions? Is there anything I said that didn't make sense, didn't hold together, or that I skipped over too fast? And thank you, those of you that knew all about the Zapatistas and the Independent Community Center, for sitting through the explanation. I just want to make sure it was grounded for everybody in what I was talking about. Because if not, then the whole thing makes no sense. Okay, good. All right, so that's some stuff to kind of think about. And this is the part where we kind of get down to the nitty-gritties of, okay, so we're here, we're in Indianapolis, what are we going to do? And, you know, I don't know the answer. I'm a carpetbagger, and I leave here tomorrow, so there's nothing that I can do to actually make this happen at all. You know, that has to come down to kind of to you guys. But I thought we would sort of popcorn a little bit about co-ops and collective work. And then maybe sort of taking this all together, maybe kind of break up into small groups and talk a little bit about, you know, what can we do with a media co-op? You know, what can we do with a public space? And it's really important to think of it as a public space. There's a movement called Reclaim the Streets. Have any of you heard of Reclaim the Streets, or did that not make it to here? Okay, you have. Has anybody else? Okay, so Reclaim the Streets is kind of a, it's a, you know, it's a young person's movement, and the idea, and, you know, Occupy sort of grew off this, is that essentially our outside world is pretty constrained and pretty privatized, and we don't really have the free run of the world that we're in. And that the whole business of going to something that's defined as private property and reclaiming it as public space for a period of time, be it 10 hours, 12 hours, 24 hours, is a huge thing. It makes a huge difference. Essentially, we create a commons for a while, you know, a public space. So they would reclaim a street and just say, the street is closed, no cars, this is for the people, and we're just going to be here and have a carnival for 8 hours, 10 hours, as long as the police will let us do it. And this is broken out in various cities across the world, actually. Started out in London, New York, and has kind of jumped around since then. Admittedly, it works better in a big city because of the density of the population. In a place like Indianapolis, we probably have to do it, you know, right downtown, where it wouldn't have as much impact. But it's essentially, it's a physicalization of the idea of a commons. And what I sort of want to do here is to, you know, think of this internet space as the same kind of thing, but not just for 24 hours. You know, it's a reclaiming of a public space in order to assert reality in whatever way that works for people. And, you know, how do you provide those tools, and then how do you set up that kind of beautiful synergy where the stories start to talk to each other and reality starts to shift because things are together in proximity that were not together in proximity before. And by there being so many of them, they build up a kind of a force. So does that make sense at all?
Yeah.
The idea of the digital commons? Okay. So all right, so let's go back to kind of logistics, which is like practical stuff. So if you don't want to emanate a kind of a hierarchical structure and set up a new organization, you know, website co-op.inc, and, you know, put you in charge and make you the CFO and tell you to go out and can raise grant money, which you could do, but it would be a different kind of thing. If you actually wanted to set up a sort of, you know, a public space that wasn't owned, but that was available to the community, how would you do that? What things would you need to have in place? And, yeah.
Could you set up, could there be a social co-op media Facebook page?
Yeah, you probably want to set up a Facebook page or Twitter account and all those things.
I mean, that anybody, of course,
yeah, if you have a Facebook page and anybody can put anything up on it, it would be unreadable in like 2 days.
Well, I
can imagine like everybody's Facebook page all put together.
I mean, for Indianapolis, for community co-op.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so you need websites, server space, that kind of mechanical stuff. But I'm actually kind of talking about the people structure. Okay. Well, obviously, you need a group of people. They're going to be, you know, putting stuff up and making content, because your website without content is really, very interesting. And making it available for people to put out content and getting the word out about that content. Let's appoint a couple of you to the imaginary board, because I just want to make a point here. So, okay, so you're on the board, you're on the board, you're on the board, you're on the board, and you're on the board. Okay, we picked those five people and decided they are the board. So they're going to curate the content that's coming in, make decisions, and put it up. And the rest of you are not the board, okay? You're just not. We didn't pick you. How would you sort of navigate that sort of a situation? What kinds of things would come up? What could you do to avoid how you just felt when I announced that some of you were on the board, some of you were not on the board? Because you felt a certain way, because that's the reaction that brings out in our society.
Relieved.
Yeah.
Nothing, I just felt relieved. About who's in charge and who's the boss. And Americans love to say who's the boss, that's like our favorite.
expression. You know, and that's how you avoid that kind of anti-authoritarian impulse. Because you try to create that kind of balance inside of a system. You have more authority within the project, well, you do 3 times the work. That's the deal. And if you keep that up, make all the decisions that you want. God bless you. But you're the one doing 3 times the work. And that's what puts you in that position. So it isn't arbitrary, it isn't cronyism, it isn't nepotism, it isn't who you know, it isn't who you're friends with. It's really how much work and time and energy can you put into this project. And if the truth is you can't put the work into the project for a period of time, then you kind of step back a little and somebody else steps forward, and so a collective kind of recedes in that way. It refills itself. But there's a direct relationship, and it's reasonably transparent, you know, who's in these positions, because they're working a lot. They're sweating. It's obvious. You can see it. They're always there. They're the ones doing the work. So that's something you have to kind of keep in mind about sort of how you sort things out on a collective in a transparent way, because if you don't do that, then it really does become about who's friends with who. And once that starts, it can get a little poisonous. You know, once that starts, that's like the biggest hole that you can kind of fall into. Because any kind of cronyism and nepotism is like that. It just never works. So kind of have to figure out with any of these projects, you know, what's the level of commitment relationship? And if I put in this amount of time, this amount of energy, this is how I interact with the project. And just keep that consistent and make it apply to everybody. And then the project can kind of move forward. And it means it isn't dependent on one person or 2 people or 3 people. Because other people can fill those positions too. They just have to make the commitment and do the work. And people can step back at a certain point in time. Because I don't know if some of you have ever had this experience. Sometimes you create a project, and then because you're the only one that knows how it works, it can't continue without you. And it becomes like a big, you know, 600-pound weight around your chest. And at a certain point, you almost end up killing it because you just can't stand it anymore. And it doesn't live without the original people that founded it. And it has to. I mean, if it's going to be a meaningful co-op or a collective, it has to live beyond the original people that started up. And you have to set up a system where that can happen, where people can step into your role. Because you could get hit by a truck, who knows, and you don't want the entire Indianapolis media co-op to disintegrate because one person got hit by a truck. You really don't. How many of you have lived in situations with roommates? Okay, everybody, right? This is how life works. Okay. So if you had one thing that you could say to someone else who was getting a roommate for the first time, what would you say? Just one piece of advice.
Talk about things first.
Okay.
Expectations.
Learn to communicate.
No passing grace and sticky notes.
Yes. Exclamation point on that. Okay, so this kind of basic stuff. Any collective work, you know, same thing. These are important things to remember. And these are important things to identify and hold each other. Happened, and here's why. That can be fine. know, it just needs to be sort of your personal expression about what you spend the majority of your time doing. Think about what that would be. And maybe we'll sort of have you describe that in some little groups. And then we're going to think about what would be the impact of all of these things put together. If, say, we had the 5 or the 10 things put together here that each of you would kind of come up with. And then I want you to multiply that for the whole freaking city. And think about what the impact would be of those things put together. You know, that's the potential of a project like this. Because I suspect that what some of you come up with will be very different than what you would think, even if you know each other. And besides, I want to hear what all put up. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to break up into groups of, I don't know, I guess groups of 3, given this kind of size. And we're going to talk a little about, we're going to answer that question, you know, if we basically needed to kind of, you know, what's the most important thing that we would share about our primary activity, the work that we do? You know, if we had 3 minutes to sort of express what it is, why we do it, what matters about it. And then a little bit about what, you know, what you think you could get out of a call. Because like any project, it's all about what people can get out of it. So what you think that you could get out of a project like that. What you could give and what you could get. And if you don't know the answer, that's okay. But I think it would be good just to see kind of what people come up with. So we could exchange those 2 pieces of information with each other, and then we'll kind of come back talking. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think we could do, let's do 3 groups so they're fairly small. And I guess the way we do that is we count off 1, 2, 3 and then the groups. So you could start.
1, 2, 3, 4, 3.
3.